This is a very special occasion for Holy Cross, for the parish of Ramsbury in Axford, and for the village. It marks the completion of the restoration of the organ by Nicholson of Malvern, a project which was so generously funded by so many, including many of you who are here tonight, and of that more later. We are honoured and delighted to welcome James O'Donnell, organist and master of the choristers at Westminster Abbey, to Holy Cross, and we're thrilled by the alacrity and enthusiasm with which he accepted our invitation to give this inaugural recital. So please, would you give him a very warm welcome.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much indeed for the invitation to give this inaugural recital. For an organist, it is a great privilege to be invited to do this, and I'm delighted to be here and to play this concert this evening. The programme is constructed in various sections. The next section is a distinctly Westminster Abbey connected section. The two works I'm going to play are by composers who were firstly directly and secondly less directly connected to the Abbey. Henry Purcell was organist of Westminster Abbey in the late 17th century, and his role as organist would in those days have been chiefly to improvise and also probably to walk downstairs and actually sing with the choir as well. Things were a little bit more informal, and the boundaries were less clear in those days than perhaps they are today. But he wrote very little organ music down, but the piece I'm going to play, the Voluntary for a Double Organ, is one of his undoubted masterpieces in the genre. And the title means an organ simply with two divisions or two manuals. And this is an example of a two-manual organ with two keyboards, and each keyboard controls a different section of stops. So you can play them separately and make a contrast between them, which is the point of the Purcell work, or you can play them together by coupling them mechanically together, so you can play the whole sound together with the instrument. So the double organ in Purcell's day would have been what they called a chair organ or a choir organ. In other words, a part of the organ where the pipes were behind the player, and the great organ would have been the main part of the organ in front of the player. So there's a contrast between the two divisions. The chair organ is the smaller sound that you can hear, and the great organ is the bigger sound. Now, of course, on this instrument, there isn't a chair organ, so I'm just using the gentler division to substitute for that. And then the Handel organ concerto that I'm going to play. There's a long tradition of playing organ concertos just by the organist alone. Even in Handel's day, it was quite common for a player to play the music and to fulfill the parts, both of the orchestra, or the string orchestra, and the organ soloist. Handel himself was a very good organist, and he played these concertos often in the intervals of the oratorios which he was directing. So there's a direct Handel connection. The Westminster Abbey connection is that he is, of course, buried in Westminster Abbey.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm going to finish the first part of this concert with music now from the German tradition. Two very different composers. Schumann wasn't really an organist. He instead was fascinated by an organ-like instrument, a pedal piano, in other words, a piano with an organ-like pedal keyboard attached to it. And he wrote quite a few pieces for this instrument, including a set of canonic studies and also some very good fugues on the theme BACH, which is a German musical way of notating the composer's name in tribute to him. But the canonic study in A-flat is a very interesting piece, as you can tell from the title. You can hear the canon between the two main voices accompanied by an undulating accompaniment of repeated chords. It's very lyrical and shows the kind of song-like abilities of the organ and the gentler colours of the instrument, although it becomes a little turbulent and a little bit more emotionally involved in the middle and then subsides again. The Mendelssohn work is the first movement of one of his six organ sonatas. These are rather interesting. They were written at the request of an English music publisher. Mendelssohn visited England and indeed Scotland and played the organ quite a lot. He brought a knowledge and an expertise in continental organ technique, which to the British Isles at that time was quite revelatory, and involved a lot of difficult work on pedals, which English organists had not really got their minds around at that stage. The Mendelssohn opened their minds to the possibilities of the pedal board, and he had composed quite a few movements which he then rearranged to create a series of six sonatas. This is, I think, one of the greatest movements of these sonatas. It's full of sunlight and joie de vivre, which is quite extraordinary considering the chorale tune, or the German hymn tune, which is quoted in the middle of it, is Aus tiefer Not, from the depths I cry to you, O Lord. And this becomes woven into an increasingly involved emotional web, and then finally bursts out into the triumph of the A major key at the end. It's really a rather wonderful piece. The second part of this concert tonight has a distinctly Parisian flavour, as you'll see. All but one of the composers was the organist of one of the major churches in Paris. Saint-Saëns was organist of the Madeleine, Franck was organist of Saint-Clotilde on the left bank, and Dupré was for many years organist of Saint-Sulpice, the enormous church on the left bank. And the arranger of the Debussy movement was also a very well-known organist and a respected composer in his own right. Organists occasionally play lots of French organs. There's a great deal of it, and a lot of it is extremely good. And French organists have a knack of reacting to the characteristics of the instrument with particular accuracy and capturing them in the style of their music. And I think you're going to hear that in a couple of the pieces, certainly the first two pieces particularly. The Fantaisie in E flat is in two short movements. The first is a delightful scherzo, where originally three sounds, but in fact on this organ I'll just use two because there are only two, it works perfectly well, sort of ricochet against each other in rapid succession. And also a little song-like melody emerges in the wispy phrases from time to time. And the second section is a march full of élan and joie de vivre, and it's really kind of robustious. That's the kind of livelier side of the organ. Then the next piece is much more introspective, the Franck prelude fugue and variation, and it follows exactly the shape suggested by its title. And Franck specifies the use of the oboe stop. Sometimes on organs there are stops which imitate quite closely other instruments, and the oboe is one of the prime examples of this. And you'll hear this playing very beautiful, rather wistful melody, then an interlude leading into a fugue, and then finally the melody returns with a much more intricate accompaniment on a flute stop. The composer Liszt heard this piece and thought it was one of the most beautiful melodies he'd ever heard. Then I'm going to play the arrangement of the Andante from Debussy's string quartet. I couldn't resist doing this today because the date, as you can see, of the composition of the quartet almost exactly coincides with the date which this organ was put in this position and renovated by William Hill, which is a sort of landmark moment in the history of instruments. So it seemed like a wonderful serendipitous thing to play it. And again, you can see a side of the organ which is capable of imitating and capable of adapting instrumental sounds very, very well. So you can imagine a string quartet playing this music, and of course the original version by Debussy, who was not an organist and didn't write organ music at all, so far as I know. But you can also hear this as a piece of organ music in its own right. The arrangement by the organ is so skillful. Finally, a short toccata by Dupré, who was, of course, the arranger of the very first piece that I played of Bach. And Dupré, one of the great organ virtuosos of all time. You can hear a certain amount of that in the wonderful coruscating toccata, based on a plainsong hymn. You hear the hymn in slow notes in the pedal bar throughout the toccata, and flashes of wonderful virtuosic colour the manuals above.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. It's very extremely kind of you. Since we're on a French theme, it would be, I think, inappropriate to finish without some dessert. So I'm going to play a French... Well, I'm going to play a bonbon. It's not at all French, actually. It's English. It's a piece you might recognise by William Walton.
Just had it. Organist and the committee, and Nicholson's of Malvern, who took the organ to pieces bit by bit by bit, took it all away, and had it back in the church ahead of schedule, perfectly restored. Thanks to the sponsors, the Hilldrop Charity Collection and the Payne Galway Charitable Trust, who have underwritten all the expenses so that every penny that we've raised today can go into the church funds. Thanks to the brilliant flower arrangers. Thanks to the ushers. Thanks to the Friends of Holy Cross who made the food. To Lois and Ian Smith for yet again giving up their time, a lot of time, to be the bar personnel. To Philip Perkins for hours and hours and hours of work put into the film that we saw in the Memorial Wall and we shall certainly see again. To Michael Hanford for being PC Plod. To the bell ringers. To Emma for being the ticket office. And to those who helped set up the church, etc., etc., etc. You know who you all are, and thank you. But perhaps most of all, we want to thank you, who were the most generous and hard-working organ donors. The money came pouring in from individuals, charitable trusts, and from the many, many community fundraising projects in the village. A perfect example of a village that has always followed the big society principle of volunteering. And now we have an organ of which Ramsbury can be really, really proud, and we are. Then we must thank the rector for allowing us to use the church for the concert. You may have noticed why we've been sitting and listening, but this is honestly one of the most beautiful churches in the country. If you haven't noticed, maybe you should try a quick visit to Spectators. It is deservedly a Grade 1 listed building. In your programmes, you will have received an application form to join the newly set up Friends of Holy Cross. Its purpose is to keep raising funds for the upkeep of this village, which is this building, which is the very heart of the village. The first project is to restore the lich gate, which is lovely, but in need of quite major repairs. Friends will be notified first and have priority booking at all future concerts, and we're planning a few. Please fill in the form and join us. It need only cost £1 a month. To quote John Betjeman, though for the church we may not seem to care, it is deeply part of us. Thank God it's there. If on the other hand you're already a great friend of your own church, but have had a really lovely evening, there will be ushers at the door to receive any donations you've been able to give. Even better, if you put your money into one of those little yellow envelopes in your pew, Mr. Osborne has said that he will kindly add another 25%. And that makes all the difference, actually. Anyway, time's up. Thank you, James, very, very much. And thank you all for coming and being such a great audience. It has indeed been a very special and a very memorable concert. Yeah.